Good morning. All right. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome in. I hope you have enjoyed the drive to church on this beautiful June morning. It is gorgeous outside, maybe a tad bit on the humid side, but it is a gorgeous morning on this planet, and it is a gorgeous morning in the life of this church. We get to come together and worship some Jesus. So welcome in. We're glad you're with us. If you're here in person or if you're online, wherever you are, we're so glad you're with us this morning. To get started, just a couple of announcements. The first one is just to draw your attention to the summer cereal drive that we're having. There's information on the bulletin you got if you want to look there. If you didn't bring a box of cereal with you this morning, that's okay. If you want to grab one of those envelopes in front of you or any slip of paper you have and wrap it around a dollar bill, $1 buys a box of cereal. So that is an easy way to get involved in the missions of the church. Or if you happen to go to the store later today to do all your weekly grocery shopping and you see this massive sale on cereal, scoop some extras up and come drop them off at the church office. It's just something we're trying to do to help give back. I think that's really all the big announcements I have this morning. Check your emails. I know that Miss Denise every week sends out a This Week at Salem to kind of keep you updated on the happenings and lives in the church that we have going on. Exciting ways to be involved, to get invested in the church, and to give back. So I encourage you to check your emails and do that. But for now, brothers and sisters, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, what an amazing day it is on your planet, the one that you created, knowing that we woke up this morning and you gave us this day just special for us. Lord, I pray this morning that as we come together as one body of Christ to worship your name, that you would send your spirit to this place. You'd send this spirit into our homes or wherever we may be and just allow it to fill us up as much as possible so that we are overflowing with your love. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you all please stand and join us this morning in our You Are Holy. Thank you. I couldn't remember.
Peace, and I will live.
Now take another deep breath before we start on Everlasting God, because you're going to need it. Okay.
We wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our sure deliverer. You are the
kiddos, y'all come on up. It is your time up here with Miss Rachel. If you don't want to come up front, that's okay. You can stand up in your pew so you can still see and wave at her and distract her from her children's time. But y'all come on down, kiddos.
Good morning. So you're going to want to be up here for this. I told Reagan right before I walked down here, I'm talking about her during children's time. And she's like, what are you going to say? I said, it doesn't matter. I'll tell you later. I'm at least telling you ahead of time. So I've got some things I'm going to show off, and I'm going to brag a little bit on Reagan, okay? I mean, she's 12 now, but I've got some drawings that she has made for me over the years. I think this one is me. It might be her. We'll see. Doesn't it look awesome? I think this is actually, I had to take it down. You can still see there's tape. This is taped up in my office, actually. Like, okay, I get it. I think, though, since this one does not have glasses, and this was whenever I was still wearing glasses a lot when she was little, before I really wore my contacts a lot. So I think this one's her, because there's not glasses on it. I've got a better one, though, okay? This one we can figure out. This says, Mommy, I love you, Reagan Powell, just in case I forgot her last name. See, there's both of us. We have become triangles now instead of just a head, right? These are really good, right? And what about this one? This one is Happy Mother's Day, and this says, you, and Reagan. So we can see now we actually have bodies. They're getting better, right? Pretty good? So we can kind of see these, okay. And then eventually we got to where we have color sheets, right? And then I have one, I'll have to show it to you on my phone. And this is one of my favorite drawings that she did. This is actually from school. And so you can kind of see on the website, some of your parents know what I'm talking about. She actually did, I mean, like, it became a cardinal. I know no one else can see it, but I don't know if Ruben can see that or not. It's on a phone, so probably not. But she did this one. So the cardinal compared to her, I think. We still aren't quite sure. That's a big difference, right? But do you know that I look at this drawing with the exact same like pride and love, because my baby girl drew that, compared to the way I look at the cardinal painting that we actually have the real one at home? Like, I look at these the same way. They are both still so, so special. Now, I can look at this one and be like, crazy hair day that day, right? But I still look at it the same way. And God looks at us the same way. Our crazy hair days, or maybe our crazy attitude days, we don't have those, right? Y'all don't have crazy attitude days, do you? No, maybe. Or those days whenever things just aren't going exactly right, or maybe you messed up a little bit, or even on those days when you do really, really good and everything went right. God looks at you the same way on those days that he looks at you on those amazing days. He still sees you that he loves, and he still sees you that he loves the exact same way each and every day, because you are so, so special. So we may have our round head body days sometimes, and that's allowed, right? That's okay. We make mistakes. But we also have those amazing days, and he looks at us the exact same way. And I don't know about you, but I've got some days where I may have just a round head and that's it. And I am so, so thankful that God looks at me the exact same way on this day and loves me just as much on this day as he does on those good days. Doesn't that make you happy? That makes me pretty happy. All right, let's pray real quick, okay? Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for these boys and girls. Lord, thank you so much that each and every day, no matter if it's a good day, an in-between day, a bad day, or even just a crazy day, you look at us the same each and every day, full of love and pride, and you just love us so much, Lord. Please help us to remember that on our good days and those bad days, that we know that you're looking down on us just full of joy and love. Help us to spread that love, though, to everyone else in this world. Please continue to keep us safe, and we pray all of this in your name. Amen. All right, so it's almost summer. It is summer now, isn't it? It's almost vacation for me. It's summer. So make sure that you're listening to your parents. I was going to say listen to teachers, but we don't have to right now, right? Listen to your parents. Wash your hands. Be nice to your brothers and sisters since we're all at home right now, okay? Remember that we love you, but most importantly, remember that God loves you, okay?
Pause for just a moment of prayer and sharing in joys and concerns. I will invite you, if you didn't have an opportunity, maybe on your way in, just to hear and share in some of the joys or concerns. You might have picked up a bulletin on your way in. We celebrate an anniversary this week. We celebrate with Dale and Becky Winslow an anniversary. Birthdays upcoming this week for Anna Marie Rousey, Becky McPeak, Lydia Cheatham, and our very own Joel Turpin has a birthday this week, birthday boy. So just some of the anniversaries and birthdays. We might have missed one. Please let us know. You could just grab a prayer card from your pew even and make a mark of a birthday or an anniversary or other joys that you might want to share. Many joys to share in the life of the church this week. One of those joys is, I know Brody had a swim meet yesterday, I think. And how did it go, B? All right, double thumbs up, so congrats And school's out and summer is beginning. I know lots of joys for kids. This week we announced the joy of our VBS, which is going to be out of this world later on in the summer. And now I'm struggling. I know Mars is in the title, but tell me the title. To Mars and Beyond will be coming later in the summer, as well as camp meetings. So joys still yet to come. We hope in a couple of weeks to have an outdoor service in the arbor on the 4th of July as well, and to share in that joy. A joy of thanksgiving to those who helped yesterday with preparing for camp. I know we're already starting the process of looking over the arbor and making ready. A couple of joys as well, that we soon will begin clearing out the kitchen in hopes of our renovation project. And so we celebrate that joy. I celebrate a joy with you today that is last week. I was blessed to receive an appointment to be the pastor of the Salem United Methodist Church, and I am grateful for the opportunity. Well, thank you. I know it's been a long, hard year. I've probably bumbled it and fumbled it plenty of times. You know, I like to think maybe that our old preacher's gone and I can be, you know, the old me and the old year. And like the butterfly, maybe I can have a better year next year. So I'll try harder and you help me to grow to be better. But I do look forward to many things that we'll share in this year. And truly, I'm grateful to be here and to be with you in the life of our community. I also, though, now want to share a few concerns. On our prayer list, there are a number of names listed there of some who are sick and shut in, of those who have experienced loss. We continue to think of the Wilson family, Carol having lost her mom. But a couple of other concerns to share with you as well. One is to lift up the name of Coy James. Some of you, many of you may know Coy and Minna James. They're not members of our church, but they've lived here in the Salem community for a long time. Coy passed unexpectedly this weekend. And so we lift prayers for Coy and Minta and their family. They live right over on Joyce. They're backdoor neighbors to Philip and Leslie Younce. And I guess they have been for years and years. But we do ask prayers for the family, for Minta and all of her family. Randy and Minta are cousins. My understanding is the Reeds and the Masons. Anyway, they're all cousins. But we lift them in prayer. I don't have details fully about the service for Coy's life. The family will be meeting with folks at Ashby's tomorrow to make some arrangements. And in the midst of Methodism, some of us here are Methodists, long-timers. I know we have some guests this morning, maybe Methodist or not. But as we're in transition, there's preachers moving here and there. I'll be serving the family later this week when they make plans for the service. And I know Brother Randy will be singing. And so there will be a good time to be had if you want to reach out and lift up prayers for the family or come to the service. We'll post the information in the life of our church when we have it. And like I say, if you want to drop by and say hello, they're right there on Joyce. I'm sure there'll be a yard full of cars probably this afternoon praying for the Razorbacks. So just a word for them. Also an announcement that I guess it's both a joy and a concern, but to lift up, I'm sure you may have heard this weekend the news that our beloved Miss Rachel Powell, following 11 years in leadership in children and family ministry, will be stepping down when school starts, that July will be her last month in leadership of our children and family ministry. I think some of you may have gotten a copy, may have received a copy of the letter, but through the course of this pandemic, as a family, as things have slowed down, and as their little daughter now is a 6-foot-tall supermodel, with just a few years till she gets her car and moves to Europe or something, Rachel wants to focus more as a mom and as a family, and so we celebrate her choice and their choice as a family. It will be a sadness for us that she will move on from our children's department. And so later in the summer, as we get closer to Vacation Bible School and camp meeting and so forth, we'll have an opportunity to celebrate her ministry with us, to share cards and gifts and to give thanks for her ministry. Russell and Rachel are not moving away. They're not missionaries to South America or a foreign country as I know it. They're still going to continue to be members and missionaries in the life of our church. Russell will continue in leading our student and family ministry and in many ways continuing to grow as our assistant pastor. But we do celebrate her ministry in the life of our church. I want to take, though, a moment now just for silent prayer and then to pray together for the joys and the concerns that we share, and to take a moment as well in that prayer to give thanks for the life of Rachel Powell, who has been raised up as once a kid and a youth herself in the life of our church and has given a great deal of her life as a young adult to the life of our church and to children and their families. May we bow our heads. God, we truly do give you thanks for the gift of this day. And God, we give you thanks for the lives of so many in the life of our church and community that we pray for this day. We pray for the sick. We pray for those recovering and building strength. We think of Kathy DeWeard and recovering from her fall and her fracture. We continue to pray for Sonny Meredith as he also builds his strength. We pray for Charles Rushing and Melvin Sossman. We pray too this day, Lord, for the family of Minta and Coy James in the passing of Brother Coy. We pray for safekeeping of the family and friends as they will gather today and this week. We give thanks for his life and his faithful witness. We pray for all those who will gather to remember him and to celebrate his life. We pray that you would comfort Minta and the family, that their grief even and their tears might be mixed with joy in the memory of the life which they have shared. And Lord, this day too, we pray and give thanks for Rachel. We thank you, Lord, for her faithfulness and for her leadership and her creativity and her energy. We pray, Lord, for her teaching and leading and even her Christian witness as a leader in our public schools and an educator. We pray, God, for her marriage, for she and for Russell as they continue to grow in God's love, in the love of neighbor and in the love of their home and their friends and family. We pray a blessing over her today, Lord, for her and Reagan, for her mom and dad, and for all of their family. We give you thanks for how much they have given of themselves, Lord, for your glory through this church and in this community in Arkansas. We pray, God, that as well that you will continue to move in the lives of our children and families as we prepare this summer to continue to take trips and share in Sunday school and VBS. And God, in your perfect time, that you would bring into us and from among us our next leader. But Lord, bless her and keep her now and always. And for her ministry, we give you thanks. And Lord, as we give ourselves to you this day, seeking to be your disciples, we simply pray together as you teach your disciples to live. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Just before we pause to share our offering, I want to say a word, especially to our guests who are in worship with us today, and that is, first, that we're not passing offering baskets. We haven't been for a little while, but they're in the back of the church, and if there is a prayer request you would like to share, we would be grateful to receive either your joy or concern. If you'll simply mark it on the card, you can drop it in the baskets on either side of the sanctuary as you leave from worship this morning. But I want to say to you as well, as our guests, that we don't want you to put any money in the basket, not to make a tithe or an offering. Perhaps you may have a church home and that's where your tithe belongs. You may be a guest and be in worship here and other places in your journey, and we wish you well in your journey. Should you choose to make Salem your home, we would welcome you. But we invite you simply as you're a guest and visiting to know that your presence in worship is your gift, not your offering, but simply your presence is your first offering. And we're glad that you're here. If you didn't know, as you came in, the restrooms are to my right, to your left through these doors at any time, and we worship as families with kiddos and flip-flops and coloring books and toys. But if you should need a play space, there is a preschool area to my left out these back doors, and even a little soothing space, a cry room, a playroom in the back. But we are grateful that you are here. Just before we pray over our offering, though, we have some big news to share today. And it's not about inflation. In fact, it's the opposite of that. And so I want to invite Suzanne Thomas, our treasurer, to come and share some good news that you may not have heard that happened on Friday in the life of our church. Suzanne?
Approximately 8 years ago, our church embarked on a capital campaign to be able to pay off the mortgage that we had here at the church. There have been so many of you that have given so faithfully all these years, over and above your tithe, for us to be able to make our monthly payments. But on Friday, I hand-delivered a check to the bank that paid off our mortgage in full. We are debt-free.
I think you need to give yourself some more praise, for real. I think you may need to clap your hands again and pat yourselves on the back. This is a hard-working church, folks, if you don't know that. People here work hard. They save their money. They give generously. They've looked after this campus since the Civil War. And in your faithfulness, year after year, in trying to make the ends meet at home and at church, you have done something remarkable, especially in a season when our economy's crazy and nobody knows what's happening next and inflation's on the rise and interest rates are running up. We are debt-free, folks. You know, Jesus has forgiven our sins, but our financial debts are no more. We ain't no nobody nothing, you see. Every dollar in the plate we use for God's glory, not for interest. Amen? Amen? Every dollar, every dime, every nickel in the life of our church is for our ministry. And I want to say again, thank you to so many people that did so many things. I want to say thank you to Joel. I know that working up and fixing our house next door is a part of that process. Lots of sweat equity went into that. And so thank you, Joel, and many others. Many others. Bake sales and all of the ways and Irish sales that we have worked as a church to be good stewards of what God has given us. And it's a remarkable, remarkable thing. I'm not going to burn our note. It's in the safe at our church where it should be. You know, I saw a church or two burn their note, and I thought, now why would you do that? But they did. In any case, and our deed's there too for safekeeping. I think that for sure would be crazy to burn the deed, don't you? It's been safe since the 1800s and still is in a fireproof safe. But to me, y'all, that's a great joy. That's a great joy. And so I am grateful to you, to all of you who have contributed in so many ways of your time, your talent, and your treasure to the life of our church, to the life of our church. Let me say, too, while we're in this vein, we are not borrowing one penny to renovate this kitchen, not one cent All of the monies that have been faithfully given to the kitchen project and to memorial gifts in honor and in memory of people we love is money in the bank. And we won't be borrowing a penny. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to do some of the work ourselves. I doubt they'll let me use the power tools, but, you know, in any case, maybe they'll let me, you know, get some of the Tupperware out of the cabinets. And so more to come. But let us now pray and give thanks. If you're online watching, as always, too, we give thanks for you. If you want to give, of course, you can use the app and the website and all those sorts of things. If you want to drop by during the week, the office or the box, if we're out, we're grateful for your gift. But let us pray. God, we give you thanks for the gift of so many saints gathered here, some watching in, and some, God, who have gone on to glory even and received their heavenly place. Thank you, God, for the faithful stewards, generations of them in the life of our church, and for the efforts which have been made, and for the debt which has been paid in full. Thank you, God, for the gifts which are given today and this week for the ministry of your church as we seek to make disciples and Lord, to show others that you love them, that you desire to save them from their sins. And so, God, bless every gift that we bring. Every gift. There is no gift big or small. They are all gifts, and we receive them all gratefully for the ministry of our church, Lord, but for your glory. And so we pray, Lord, in your church and in your spirit and in your name, Jesus. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Nothing can change it. You're not separated. No matter where you run, He's always holding on. You're still a daughter. You're still a son. No matter what, you're still a daughter. You're still a son. No matter what.
My excitement, I got carried away and missed a couple of mentions of joys and concerns, and so I want to share a couple more before we read from our scripture. We're going to get there, I promise, and I'll go quick because I've already talked up too much of my time. We're going to get out on time for Sunday school or tea time or fishing on a free weekend, whatever you have in mind. But I don't want the hour to escape without a couple of more mentions. One, I want to continue to invite us to pray for Penny's daughter, Dustin. She's still in her fight, but things are improving. And so we want to give God a praise for the strength that Dustin is gaining, but continue to pray for her in our concerns. Also, I want to lift up a prayer. I can't remember if it was mentioned or not, or in a boneheaded way, whether I even got it in the bulletin or on the list. But the Hamiltons, now you might say, how could Leanne be having another baby? She just had a baby 8 weeks ago. That's true. It's their in-laws, and they'll be joining the church pretty soon, but their in-laws, her brother-in-law and sister-in-law are expecting and will be delivering, we believe, this week on Wednesday. Annabelle, and if I remember, Brother Randy, I think that the baby boy is going to be named Randy, if I remember correctly. So we want to pray for the Hamiltons this week, expecting their first and adding to their number and to ours. So we'll pray for a safe delivery and hope soon to see some pictures of a bouncing baby boy and maybe in a few weeks to be able to share in his blessing or his baptism. But I want to lift those two things in prayer for you. Then I also want to say welcome back, Carter. Welcome back, Crosses. We are glad that Randy and Laura are here with us in worship, having spent some vacation time away. And to say thank you again to Brother Paul, y'all, for helping to lead our band along with Steve and Rockin' Roger and our praise ladies, Miss Penny and Suzanne and Becky and Lynn. We give thanks for our praise team. But let me invite us just to bow our heads as we prepare to read. If you want to thumb along in a moment, we'll be reading as we have this month from 2 Corinthians, but let us pray for God's word. Come Holy Spirit, and as we open our Bibles, as we open your word, Father, we pray that we would see what you would have us to see, that we would hear what you would desire for us to hear, that your Son and our Savior, the Lord, our Redeemer and Friend, would speak to our hearts, each one, that each of us would receive just what is needed for the moment of now, today, and this week. That we would get what we need to get. And Lord, maybe this week we would do whatever it is that we need to do. That you would instruct our hands and feet, our thoughts. You would lead, guide, and direct our lives simply by the power of your word and your presence in our lives. And so, Lord Jesus, we pray in your name for these things. Amen. We have been reading, if you're a guest this morning, we've been reading from 2 Corinthians, Paul's second letter this month. We've been in the middle chapters, last week chapter 4 and this week chapter 5. If you want to make a mark in your Bible or highlight something on your phone, however it is, even for later if you simply want to listen along. We won't read the chapter in its entirety, but just a few verses beginning at number 14. And so I lift up God's word for us. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live would no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded even Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. The word of God for the people of God, thanks be to God. He said in there, from now on. This is a phrase that I don't think that I first heard at Sunday school or in church, but at home. It's a phrase I know as a kid that my dad had to offer as a teachable moment sometimes. Might be teaching with the switch or a leather belt for a few minutes. And then I would get a speech, a positive, encouraging, outwardly focused, forward-moving word. You know, after a correction of a mistake, and I would call that mistake a sin. Maybe I socked my sister. There's no telling. And then correction was needed, and an adjustment was needed. And my dad would say, now, from now on, we're not going to do this anymore. From now on, we're going to do this and not that. Paul, in his letter to the church, tells them very directly. In the midst of the grumbling and groaning and complaining and trouble, and I'll call a lot of that sin. Having heard it all, he says to them in this letter, from now on, we're not going to do that anymore. And specifically, he addresses in the letter not people necessarily on the outside, although he means them too. But he's looking at everyone in the life even of this small growing church and the way that they're looking at each other. One of our great strengths in a month where we're talking about playing to our strengths, you know, like a superhero, using our superpowers in our faith. One of our greatest strengths as Christians is this kind of X-ray vision that we're meant to possess and to be empowered by. This extraordinary vision that we're given where we can see things, as the Bible says, even though they not are, where yet, that we can see dimly in a mirror and one day we'll even see God face to face. That we can look and see the potential and the power in the lives of other people. We can see the resurrection in any situation that may be sick or dead or nearly gone. When we even gather at the graveside and place our hand upon pine boxes or scatter ashes, we believe, you see, with an extraordinary faith and an unsurpassable vision about a place in glory, about a mansion and many dwelling places where our Father will one day send the Lord Jesus even to call us by name. Do you know this vision, church? Do you possess this kind of eternal eyesight, and have you used it lately? To look and to see beyond simple appearances. We live in a culture and an age today and in this time that is an appearance culture. We live in an appearance culture where we sort of look at so many things, and what we seem to value is brands. What we seem to value are celebrities. What we seem to value are labors, labels, and popularity. Our culture is caught up in appearances. And thinks that everything that it is expensive or bigger or flashier is better. We're caught up in appearances in so many ways in our culture and in our world that we seem to judge everything by its shallow and surface appearance. This attitude is so pervasive in America today, in fact, that the church is just a small part anymore, even of American society. in a large suburban county like the one that maybe many of us in this room even live in, with more than 100,000 people. There are about 100 churches, and most of them, the vast majority of them, and it's true all across America as well, have less than 100 people that come and gather for worship. And the world looks at that and thinks that it's irrelevant, that it doesn't matter and it doesn't count, that it's useless. That we few people who still read the Bible and preach the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ are out of touch with this culture. We who are about grace and forgiveness and mercy are out of touch with this culture. And yet, as Paul writes, we press on. The passage tells us directly about the transformed lives that are a part of God's purpose in this world and what it is to be a new creation. We look at people sometimes like caterpillars, and maybe we think they're sticky and they're slow, that they're beneath us, of little use to us even. I heard somebody the other day grumbling about the worms on the sidewalk after all the rain, and I thought, boy, if you had a coffee can and a little dirt, you might be surprised what will happen when you get those on the end of a line and have a little bobber going up down. You might be surprised the value of those worms that appear to be a nuisance to you, how good they'll do in your refrigerator in a can. We are people who believe in the power and the possibilities of the pure gospel lived out. That God is still in the business of transforming lives, communities, and the whole world. And that His plan has never changed. He isn't like the folks over there at ESPN that don't love the Razorbacks. Now, these people will tell you that you're going to see a ball game on a certain TV channel, and you would turn there, and it won't be there. It'll be somewhere else. Then they'll decide something else is more important, and it'll be somewhere else. And they'll just keep changing the channel on you. But the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the life and teachings, the grace and faith of the Lord Jesus Christ are unchanging. Amen? They are now, tomorrow, always, and forever. I don't even need to say a whole lot more about that. Amen? You got it, right? And one day we hope that all will get it. That one day every man, woman, and child upon the earth will turn from their sin, from their wicked or slothful ways, that they will repent, that they will come to have the kind of X-ray superhero vision that we have, that they will come to see and to believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God raised from the dead, that God sent His Son into the world to save the world, not to condemn the world, but that through His Son the world would be saved. And they will confess with their lips just this, that Jesus is their Savior. Amen? It takes nothing more than that to be saved. No tithe, no offering. It takes, though, importantly, nothing less and nothing else will do. Amen? For the Lord Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one cometh unto the Father but through Him. And so we pray for lives to be changed on the streets and dirt roads and county roads, the highways and the byways of this place where we live together. That small group of us God-fearing and believing Christian people in churches big and small, downtown, under high steeples, in country churches, that all of us together seek the salvation of the whole world. That every man, woman, and child on the earth would repent of their sins and believe Jesus is their Savior. And that we would call them to know that on one day and with one prayer, your life can be changed forever and for eternity. Amen? That a person can walk down the aisle, this one or any like it. That a person can be sitting in their living room maybe, or even their camping chair by the lake, and in one moment I've seen someone get down on their knees, was with them, in fact, in a bass boat once upon a time, who gave their life to the Lord Jesus, crying and spilling tears right there on the floor of their fishing boat, and offered Christ and received Him. And from that one moment on, their life has changed forever from now on. Amen? They put the plug in the jug somehow. They set something aside. They confess maybe to God first, and perhaps even to a family member or a friend, and say, "Help me with this. I don't want this to be a part of my life anymore. From now on, it's going to be different." I know I was once a young kid that walked the aisle at the First Baptist Church in Fort Smith and knew that there were many things in my life that needed to be gone. And to pray a prayer and say, "From now on, Lord, I'm going to try to live for You." Amen. I know, and I'm no fool, though I play one regularly. I know that there are many people and situations that disappoint us and frustrate us. There's no excuse for neglect or abuse, so let me be clear. It doesn't mean that we accept the sins of the sinner, but it means that we, like the Lord teaches, seek to love them, to pray for them to leave their sin from now on, and to repent and to live for the Lord. Maybe, though, even those who have received Him, those of us who are saved, maybe even in our lives this week, though, perhaps today, and I'll be done here. Maybe there are some places in our lives, though, where lately, you know, we've sort of been hung up on our old hang-ups. Maybe our, you know, either our neck's been crooked or our shoulder's been out of whack, and somehow our heart's been a little out of whack, too. We look at other people and we're in the business of judging them. We look at the country and it's not the way we want it to be or the way God would have it to be. But we've gotten so disheartened or grumbled or groaning that we're sort of, you know, pretty negative. Maybe there are some things that are worth recovering in our very soul. Maybe when we lie down to rest tonight, there's a place in our life where if we've been groaning more than we've been grateful, that we can be thankful, that our attitude can be a little more about gratitude. Maybe there's a place in our life and a person in our life that's really been failing and flawed, and yet we want them to know that their sin is forgivable. Amen? We want them to know that, yes, that sin, in fact, is fatal. But faith in the Lord Jesus Christ is forever. Amen? I don't need to say it too many more times. We've got to learn, too. Somebody was telling me this in the midst of all of the things that aren't going the way that we want them to remind me to say, let's trust God for this. Amen? Let's trust God for this in our church. Let's trust God for this in our country and in our world. I confess, saints, there have been times when I look at the interest rates and everything and nervous as a cat, you know, at the front door of the Cracker Barrel with all them rocking chairs and just nervous as a cat. But we've trusted God for that for years, and now it's been resolved through God's faithfulness and yours. Amen? Amen. Trusting God for that. Having hope for that. I don't know about you, but I hope to be at camp meeting with a big old ice cream melting, licking it all over my face this summer. I didn't get to do that last summer, but I'm going to this summer unless Jesus comes back, and I hope I get to go. I'm going to have hope for this summer, for the good things of God in my life and in your life, that God's going to answer our prayers for people sick and shut in, for those between jobs, for some of our young families. We've got a few where somebody's trying to get their degree and raise kids. I'm going to have great hope for their success and pray just for that. I don't know about you, but I want to try to go out of my way to do everything that I can that God puts upon my heart, whatever it is. If He needs a few more boxes of cereal, I'm going to find a way to give some and simply to help someone else. I don't know what's on your list, you know, do-gooders, but do some good today and this week. And whatever happened last year and last month, that's gone. You know, even the interest last week, I got to just keep saying it. It's gone. It's gone. Today is a new day, and God is with us. To change the world. Now, that's not easy to do by ourselves, and we don't have to. The Lord is with us. We are here to change the whole world right from our little church on this hill. We are a part of God saving the whole world. May we bow our heads? God, we give you thanks that you have gone out of your way above and beyond even the grave. That in your mansion there are many dwelling places, and one day you will come and take us there by name and tell us, well done, good and faithful servant. The Apostle Paul, once even a persecutor and a troublemaker, but repented of his sins and humbly sought to tell all others of a life like none else. In the struggles of the church, in an empire, with issues in homes, in households, in marriage, in families. Sometimes there was trouble and struggle. And yet in a humble way he urged them on and told them simply, from now on we will look to the Lord and we will live by faith. That there is grace enough, mercy enough for every sin and sinner. And so Lord, this day we pray for your mission and your ministry in our community, in your church, Lord, in yours. Lift us up, Lord, today. Give us strength to rise as we go from this place about our day and our week. Let all the troubles of the past weeks or months or even year to fade away. Help us to remember the eyes are in the front of our heads and keep us moving forward. That we will be witnesses and share in testimony by our words, our deeds, and our actions to the good news of Jesus with all of our neighbors. And for your glory, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand and join us for our last song, which is Draw Me Close.
You're all I want.
Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us for service this morning. I know that we have tons of in-person Sunday school opportunities for you. So if you need a place to go, find someone that looks like they know what they're doing, ask them, and they'll get you where they're going. A little birdie told me this morning, and I know the birdie's name was Randall because it spoke English. It said that the Bethel class is going to have snacks this morning. So if that entices you, maybe you missed breakfast this morning. Okay, so Club 456 has candy. So Crusaders. All right, so we got all kind of snacks going on in this church. So if you're looking for a Sunday school class, grab somebody. They'll get you where you need to be. But brothers and sisters, I just pray this week that you go out and you do as much good as you can in all the ways that you can for all the people that you can. In Jesus' name, amen.